So Dr. Kelly Benward is from the is a professor at School of Pharmacy at the University of Waterloo. And I'm just going to turn it over to her to lead you through her presentation.
Thanks so much, Vazia. Next slide. So I'm going to take you through a slide deck. This was produced in collaboration with several physicians, pharmacists, nurses around Canada under this initiative called 19-to-0. Next slide, please. So there's three main things that we're going to go through. And I know there's a diverse group in terms of skill level, education, awareness of the vaccine, comfort with the vaccine. There's going to be people on the call, as we've already heard, who have already been vaccinated, and people who might be a ways out yet from getting a vaccine, which also might mean you don't quite know which type of vaccine you're going to get. So the three main objectives are pretty overarching then. The first is to understand how mRNA vaccines work. The second is to review the COVID-19 vaccines approved in Canada and the other vaccines coming, and to review the contraindications and precautions of these vaccines and their side effects. Next slide, please. So this is part of a series of graphics that we've been creating at the University of Waterloo. And if you have organizations that you want to work with us on adapting these, please reach out and we're happy to help you with that. But the mRNA vaccine is like a most wanted poster that tells your body how to recognize COVID-19. It can't and won't change your DNA. This is probably one of, if not the most common question that we get. Can this change my DNA? The mRNA vaccine does not change your DNA. Next slide. So how does it work then? So if you start on the left-hand side, mRNA vaccine is injected into your body. And as I said, it can't change your DNA. If you go to number two, what happens is your cells read the mRNA instructions and they start building the same kind of spike proteins that COVID-19 had. Those spikes, though, are harmless. And the thing to know about mRNA is it's extremely unstable. So a lot of the research on mRNA vaccines in the last 10 years largely focused on how to get it stable enough to actually be effective for people. That's why we're freezing it at minus 70. This is why we can't shake the vials. It's really hard to get it out to certain areas. You know, as long as we have the Pfizer mRNA vaccine, for example, that really restricts where we can reach people because it's so fragile. So you can imagine once you actually have the vaccination and it's injected into your body and it does its work, it actually dissolves or disintegrates really quickly. For number three, your immune system then sees the spike protein and it starts building a defense. And so you've got your cells here, you can see they sound the alarm and they launch an attack. This is the point at which you might feel some fatigue, aches, or a fever, but it's actually your immune system learning about how to fight COVID. So number four, now your body can recognize the COVID-19 spike protein and fight COVID-19 effectively. So once you've gone through this process, and you'll note, you're not injected with the virus, you're injected with information on how to build the virus. Another idea here, another analogy I found useful, is likening it to a post-it note, where it's almost like, you know how you write yourself little notes around the house that you leave maybe on your computer or on a cupboard, you might leave them for your spouse or a child, with some instructions on something you need them to do. They come along, they find the post-it note, they commit to memory that they have to do this thing, and they throw the post-it note out. That's really very much how an mRNA vaccine works. You learn something, you remember it, it doesn't actually change you, it just gives you a bit of knowledge or a memory. Very much the same idea. Next slide, please. And unfortunately, I could not get this to be a clear image no matter how many ways I tried it. The point here, though, is that this is a graphic on vaccine development, but this is actually part of a suite of tools from Health Canada that were released a little while ago. You can actually use these. They've got these on the Public Health Agency of Canada and Health Canada website. And basically what it's showing you is start to finish how the vaccine production happens. And so you've got the scientists working on the left-hand side at the top there. And the thing to know about the mRNA vaccines is the research actually started for this in the late 1970s. A lot of the work that's been done in the last 10 years or so is actually focused on vaccines like vaccines for Ebola, Zika, vaccines for cancer, vaccines for HIV. So this is a technology that was already being looked at quite well by the time COVID came around. So it was ready for this pandemic. Then what happens is once you've got a technology that needs to get ready to go, you've got to build it, and then you put it through trials. So the first phase number one, is where you're trying to figure out, you know, what's the dose we're going to give. So we're kind of going through this to a certain extent with children right now. We've got the adult vaccines, but we don't know the right dose for kids. So you have to kind of do this work. What is the right dose? What is the appropriate amount? And that's just with a handful of people. It's less than 100 people. Then you head into the phase two trials where you're looking more, does it actually work? Are there any big, you know, alerts here about safety? And then there's phase three, which is when you're actually going out to tens of thousands of people. And as you'll see with these mRNA vaccines, you know, it was 30,000, 40,000 people in a trial. So we'll often hear people say things like, I don't want to be a guinea pig. But, you know, one of the things to keep in mind is the people who actually signed up and consented to these phases of these trials were the ones that were actually experimented on. So in this case, what's interesting is vaccine research is slow, unfortunately. It takes years, but it's actually because of inefficiencies between each of these phases. You have to do that first little bit in those first two blocks and then wait a while to get money and then do the next, you know, phase one and then wait a while to get money and then phase two and so on and so forth. What happened in the pandemic is all around the world, they invested incredible sums of money, organized, published protocols, extremely transparent, worked with regulators, and they actually streamlined this entire process that normally takes years, if not a decade, and actually were able to condense it down to less than a year. So we often hear, you know, this vaccine research was too fast, I feel uncomfortable. But in actual fact, this is how it should work. This was an ideal state. It wasn't too fast. It was actually an example of what research could be if we ran it like this normally. Along the bottom, then what you see is all the other work that happens. So you've got to get it approved. You know, provinces have got to buy it. We've got to move it out. And that's the phase we're at now. And then the last bit there is we track to see what happens. We track to see side effects, things that were unexpected, so on and so forth. Next slide. So there's two vaccines approved for emergency authorization in Canada right now. They're both mRNA-based. So there's the Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine. That's the one that we see a lot of in our region right now, and Moderna. They're both two-dose schedules, which mean we need to touch each person two times to get them immune using these vaccines. The Pfizer one is 0 and 21 days. The Moderna is 0 and 28 days. And you've got a bit of leeway. The trials also had a bit of leeway baked into them, too. Pfizer was 16 and up and Moderna was 18 and up for the trials. And that's why you see this being used in adults right now and not children. So a while back, we heard that the studies for 12 and older were underway. And now we're starting to hear that the trials as young as 6 and older are underway as well. So that gives us hope that we'll have vaccines for children in the coming months as well. Next slide. Okay, so how effective are they? And this is an interesting thing. So Pfizer is 95% effective to protect you from having the disease, and Moderna is 94.1. And this was similar when they did all the subgroup analysis. This is similar race, ethnicity, age. And this is the moment where I was talking to an infectious disease doctor a little while back. And, you know, she said, this was the point at which I started to cry. This was her comment. For a lot of us, this so far exceeded our expectations of what a vaccine could look like in this pandemic. This was huge. And it wasn't just that 94 or 95% efficacy was huge. It was the fact that it held up across ages. Even in seniors, you were seeing these effects, which is incredible. And it's basically the best we could have hoped for in the situation. Next slide. So what about contraindications and precautions for mRNA vaccines? So you would not be offered one of these vaccines, or you should not take one of these vaccines if you have a previously confirmed allergy to a vaccine dose or a vaccine component. So that means, for example, you have the first dose of the COVID vaccine and you have an allergy, like an anaphylactic reaction, you would not be offered the second dose. That's an example of that. Another thing is if you already know that you have an anaphylactic allergy or a serious allergy to, or just to say an allergy to one of the ingredients in the vaccine, then you wouldn't be getting the vaccine. But these vaccines actually have very simple ingredients in them. So there isn't much in there. So most people actually can receive this vaccine. So the other one would be symptoms of confirmed or suspected SARS-CoV-2 infection. So if you have symptoms or you're suspected of having COVID, we would wait until you're recovered. There's some question too about waiting a few months after you've had an infection. And there's some debate. A lot of it has to do with vaccine scarcity, even if there isn't enough supply and you have some immunity. But this is a big debate that people are having. Another is acutely ill individuals as a precautionary measure. That has to do with making sure that when you get the vaccine, you're healthy so you can have a full immune response. It's actually about efficacy. And individuals who have received another vaccine in the past 14 days. So the common one here would be the Shingrix vaccine or a pneumonia vaccine, for example. And again, it's just about making sure or ensuring that you get the most efficacy that you can. Next slide. So what about allergies? Let's go back to those a little bit. Allergy rates do seem to be higher with the mRNA vaccines, but in all cases, outcomes have been good. So what we do is we recommend that people who have a history of anaphylaxis to other allergens should wait 30 minutes post-vaccine. So most people wait 15 minutes. If you have a history of this, you may be asked to wait 30 minutes just to be sure. And 90% of these anaphylactic events have happened within that 30-minute period. The other thing to note here is that, so with a flu shot, for example, rates of anaphylaxis might be 1 in 1,000,000. With mRNA vaccines, it's about 10 in 1,000,000. So it's still not a common encounter. We wouldn't expect it, but every vaccine center is trained to deal with anaphylaxis like this. Next slide. So as your immune system learns from the COVID vaccine, you may have some fatigue, headache, achy muscles, chills, and a low fever, feeling slightly bad for a short time as you build immunity for a long time. So again, these side effects with this too are a sign that it could be, it's working, and these aren't necessarily a bad thing. These can be a good thing. Next slide. So what should I remember from the side effects of this vaccine? So the number one thing for you to know is 8 in 10 people complain of a sore arm. After you get a vaccine, your arm's probably going to hurt. So the vast majority of people are going to have a sore arm, but only 1 in 100 actually call that soreness severe. So the big one that we hear people say it's like is the Shingrix vaccine. They often say after the Shingrix vaccine, oh, it hurts a little bit. Same thing with this one. 5 in 10 people complain of fatigue and headache, but only 1 in 10 need Advil or Tylenol. And I want to point out there too, there were actually pretty high numbers of fatigue and headache in the placebo group. And when I saw that, one of my first thoughts is that's just kind of what it feels like to live through a pandemic. So, you know, there's kind of what you feel like at a baseline, and then you may have some additional effects after you have the vaccine. And some reaction to the vaccine is expected, but the majority are mild and easily manageable at home. You're most likely to have these effects 2 to 3 days after you get the vaccine. They're generally short-lived. They're more common after the second dose, and they're more common in younger people. Next slide, please. So these numbers, they haven't been updated since January. I was looking at them right before this presentation, and we're well over 1 million doses administered now. I think we're at 1.3 million doses. But one of the things that we hear from groups is that when they're the priority groups, it can feel sometimes like being guinea pigs. It can feel sometimes like they are being pushed to the front in a new vaccine we know very little about. But one of the things that's happening now is millions of people around the world have been given these doses. Millions of people around the world have been given these vaccines, and things are going really, really well. And so people now in populations who are getting them are actually high priority groups as opposed to experimental groups. And I think that can sometimes be important for people. It can be anyone, you know, who might feel like it's a little bit too early. You can rest assured that millions of people have been given these vaccines at this point. Next slide. So here's an example of a Q&A that we created, and these are the main questions that we've gotten. So I've already talked about the vaccines being developed so fast and because it was such an efficient process. We've also talked about how mRNA vaccines don't change your DNA. And the other question we get is, are the ingredients in mRNA vaccines safe? So yes, they're safe. They're often called preservative-free vaccines. How we actually preserve them is we freeze them at crazy cold temperatures, which it turns out is really complicated for actually administering to large populations, but works really well for actually getting that mRNA to be stable. There's other things in there. So you've got your unstable mRNA. So how we stabilize it is we surround it by a fatty layer, a fatty nanoparticle layer, and with polyethylene glycol is one of the ingredients in that. Very common ingredient. We see it in a lot of things. So that helps it keep its structure, and then some salt, sugar, and water. There are no blood products, no pork products, no fetal tissues, nothing like that. They're actually very simple vaccines in terms of ingredients. And then the last big question we get is, but we still need long-term data. And this is absolutely a valid point. We actually do need long-term data. Now, we don't need, it's not safety data we're waiting for, though, it's efficacy data. So in vaccine trials, side effects we're looking for are in the first 6 weeks after vaccination. The first few days, you're looking for the side effects we've already talked about, sore arms, fatigue, headache, that's normal. About 6 weeks out, up to 6 weeks out, we might be looking for things like Guillain-Barré or very specific neurological things. Now, to be clear, viruses often cause those things as well. So we know with vaccines in the past, serious side effects like that are often not just caused by the vaccine, they're actually caused often in greater proportions by the illness, if you actually catch the illness. So we watch for 6 weeks in the trials. But what we're actually waiting for now long-term is to know how long do these vaccines last? Do you need a booster? When do you need a booster? And the last big question we're really waiting for information on is, once you're vaccinated, it might protect you from feeling sick from COVID, but does it protect you from being contagious if you actually do come in contact? Next slide, please. This is another one that comes up occasionally. I don't hear it as much anymore, but I was hearing it last few weeks. Will vaccines cause infertility? In short, no, there's no evidence to support this claim. Next slide. So just a few brief words on the next one. So AstraZeneca is the next one likely to be approved in Canada. It's a viral vector vaccine. It uses a chimpanzee cold virus to actually bury that spike protein information to show to your body. The thing about chimpanzee cold viruses is they don't make humans sick, and we haven't been exposed to them, so we don't have antibodies against them. So it actually works pretty well for giving us our bodies almost like a backpack. It brings with it a backpack, your mRNA or your DNA information about the spike protein, teaches your body how to make a spike. These are fairly effective. So in the grand scheme of things, it's a fairly effective vaccine. They're not as wonderfully effective as you would see with the mRNA vaccines, for example, because like I said, those are just so overwhelming. So one of the big questions here with the AstraZeneca vaccine is, can we give the AstraZeneca vaccine now and maybe an mRNA booster later, maybe in the fall, to boost that efficacy? So waiting to see. That's also a two-dose vaccine. It's also like flu vaccines in that it's fridge temperature stored. So it's a lot easier to get out to pharmacies and doctor's offices. So that actually increases our reach by a lot. Johnson & Johnson is a very similar type of vaccine, but it's one dose, not two. So that's promising. And the Novavax vaccine, we recently heard information on because it's manufactured in Montreal. So it's a different kind of vaccine, but there's some hope for that one as well. It looks to be pretty effective. Next slide, please. So when we're considering whether, you know, from talking within our communities and talking to people about whether or not to get the vaccine, on the left-hand side, there's a lot of focus on, well, does it work? And I'm not at risk, so should I really get it? Or should I wait? You know, if I'm offered the AstraZeneca, should I wait until I get the Moderna or the Pfizer? And vaccine safety and rare side effects. But in actual fact, one of the things we need to talk a lot about is vaccines work and they're safe. We're all at risk of COVID right now. And this is really the way out. Next slide. And what you see here is just our general population's willingness. So you can see in the summer, before this was really a real idea that we knew what vaccines would be used, less than half of Canadians were willing to get the vaccine. But as time went on into the summer, into the fall and into the winter, and now in January, you can see those numbers are going up quite a bit. So the more comfortable we get, Canadians in general are more willing to get the vaccine. Next slide. So if you did get the vaccine, like Gerard at the beginning, be proud and make it public. Let people know. People are more likely to get a vaccine if their healthcare provider got it. We're also hearing in workplaces when their colleagues got it. Healthcare providers, when their patients start getting it, that can impact for them their comfort with it. So be open about this. Let people know. Let people know your experiences. Positive messaging about this vaccine is actually pretty effective. And I think that's the last slide.
Thank you, Kelly. That was very informative. I thought I'd known a lot about vaccines already, but hearing you speak and go through those slides, I picked up a few more tips and information there. So thanks for sharing that.